everybody to the last seminar in our series for this semester. I'm delighted to welcome Louise Green, who is an associate professor in the English department at this university. She was educated in literary and cultural literary studies in English at the University of Cape Town and has been here for a number of years. Her interests and teaching include critical theory, cultural studies, intellectual history, ecology, nature and environmental crisis, animal studies, and questions of value. She has recently published on Table Mountain, on the language of dogs, the social life of handmade things, on photography, and the theoretical question of a historical image. This talk, entitled The Nature Industry and the Post-Colony, frames her book manuscript with the same title. As she puts it, this manuscript, quotes, conjoins two diverse frames of reference, the practice of reading and writing developed by Theodore Adorno, and the post-colony, a term drawn from Shirin Bembe's groundbreaking study on the post-colony, and proposes Africa as an important site for philosophical engagement with the universalizing impulse that marks contemporary narratives of environmental crisis. The aim of her book is to intervene in the global rhetoric about climate change through a form which disrupts conventional notions of nature and the human. In closing, I think this is a very important discussion with which to finish the seminar series on contemporary Marxism in South Africa, and we look forward very much to your talk. As usual, you have 45 to 50 minutes for your talk, and that will be followed by 30 to 40 minutes of discussion. So please join me in welcoming you.
Thank you very much, Bernard. As Bernard has said, I'm going to present today from the introduction to my book, which is currently under review at a press which will remain nameless. The sad story of the manuscript is that I submitted it last January, at which point the press immediately went into some kind of staff meltdown crisis, and nothing happened with the manuscript for an entire year. And in fact, they just couldn't even answer an email. So now, apparently, they are back on track, and they have sent it out for review. And I'm telling you this sad story for two reasons. The first is that I haven't really looked at this work for about a year. I've been working on quite different stuff recently. And so I'm going to read the introduction, but I'll try and read it slowly. So this is a very important opportunity for me to re-engage with this material, because no doubt quite soon I'll get reams of corrections and interventions from the reviewers. So thank you very much, Bernard, for giving me this opportunity, and I'm really looking forward to feedback from all of you on the topic. The other reason why I'm telling you is that in between when I submitted this manuscript at the beginning of last year, of course several books have been published, which I should, of course, have referred to. One of these is this book by Amitav Ghosh called The Great Derangement. So these are all books which have come out on this topic, which I'm now trying to think about how I can integrate into the material. And one of the problems, I think, of working on a topic that deals with really current issues is that it's always a little dated, it's always a little out of date. Okay, so that's all I'm going to say on that. I have a PowerPoint. The PowerPoint is a sort of supplement to the talk. So I'm going to read the talk. The PowerPoint is going to quietly loop around to itself. And I've included in the PowerPoint some images from the text that I deal with in the body of the text, because part of the problem with an introduction is it's quite abstract. So I don't really engage in any real analysis. So it's more of a framing. So some of the images are from the other chapters, so if you want to ask me about them afterwards, we can always discuss them in more detail, or I can explain them. Right. Nature is a word that invites the present tense, the form for expressing general and unchanging truths about the world. Just hold on 1 second, I'm going to switch off the sound, which clearly got recorded as well. Anyone know how to do this? I'm sure. how forms of narration facilitate or limit what can be said about nature and its relation to history. How nature is complicated by the particularities of time and place. The work of this book is to make visible these forms, not through a systematic analysis of diverse discourses through which nature is daily revealed, a potentially endless task, but through strategic and selective juxtaposition of different orders of knowledge and experience. The book invites certain awkward, strange, at times uncomfortable gatherings of historical incident, artistic project, consumer choice, and cultural ephemera in which nature is found to be the decisive element. In the title, the phrase the nature industry is linked to the term post-colony with the conjunction and. On the surface, and is the most neutral and unexpressive of conjunctions, since it merely adds one thing to another without suggesting anything about that relationship. In this, it resembles the rhetorical device of parataxis. And parataxis refers to the act of placing things side by side. It is a grammatical form that assigns an equal relationship between the various words or phrases linked together. One thing is not subsumed by another. The work of this book is to place the nature industry and the post-colony in juxtaposition, to explore how each concept configures the other. There is a long tradition of writing about nature that favors observation, fact, documentation. In this book, I argue for a very different approach, one that can encompass different orders of knowledge in a non-hierarchical arrangement. I offer an arrangement of fragments of unintentional reality, and that's a quotation from Adorno, in order to investigate the particular form and complexity and history of nature in the post-colony. These arrangements are not a history in the conventional sense, although they do draw elements from different historical moments, finding present events and spaces that are pressed into shape by continuing pressure from the accumulated debris of the past. I have selected a particular intellectual trajectory. I make the claim that thinking about nature in the post-colony might best be achieved by following a tradition and a form of critique developed at another moment of extreme uncertainty, the period of the Second World War and its immediate aftermath. In this book, I argue that the approach outlined by Walter Benjamin and Theodore Adorno offers a uniquely flexible set of critical practices for articulating the diverse elements of the current crisis. What Adorno's work does, while Adorno's work does not directly address the central problematic of this book, which is the particular configuration that emerges from considering the nature industry and the post-colony in juxtaposition, he does provide a particularly compelling form for considering complex concepts, ones that circulate through diverse conceptual domains. The particular, he asserts, should not be subsumed within the general, but rather should be placed alongside the general category in a way which might disturb the system as a whole. Experience, the contingent, the ephemeral, are all relevant for a study which takes seriously the demands of a subject under investigation. And this is, of course, particularly true when considering the narrative of climate change. Documenting carbon emissions involves measuring almost all aspects of everyday life, from the use of cars to the way a myriad of electrical devices structure life, and the effects of industrial processes that underlie big infrastructural projects. The book engages in the work of making constellations, drawing on elements from art, local history, politics, popular culture, living under the sign of imminent geophysical change. The term constellation to describe a particular methodological practice or combination was first proposed by Benjamin and Adorno, and I discuss this in much more detail in chapter 2, and we can come back to that if you're interested in the kind of methodology. To refer to the current crisis invokes a kind of immediate recognition. It appears as a referent quite unproblematic. The phrase global warming has become part of a kind of shorthand of public discourse. Yet the precise dimensions of this crisis, its complexity and its strangeness, are often obscured by the frequency of its iteration. It is an unusual sort of crisis. This is in part because it occurs at an unprecedented level of abstraction. This is not to say that the effects of global warming and other forms of environmental degradation do not impact in very direct and immediate ways on people's lives, but rather to try and draw attention to the fact that what defines this crisis, its globalness, is precisely what is difficult to bring into consciousness. In the long history of what Neil Smith has called uneven development, environmental damage has always been attached to particular localities. In the 19th century, intense forms of environmental damage was associated with Britain's rapid industrialization. The manufactories in the north produced plague of smoke, which is a quote from Dickens, and the goods that generated the wealth, which approximately 100 years later were able to rehabilitate that landscape. It also produced, as an invisible side effect, the carbon dioxide that is still accumulating in the atmosphere. In the contemporary geography of capitalism, a complex checkerwork of space, industrializing, post-industrial, has emerged, where the most evident damage tends to occur in these prolonged, intense encounters with capital, which then moves on, taking with it all the paraphernalia of visibility, media attention, publicity, and expert personnel. The current mobility of capital disperses the sites of damage much more widely. But what makes the crisis global is not simply this extension of damage into previously non-industrial spaces. It is the evidence of the damage reflected back from the atmosphere, the invisible but increasingly significant rises in carbon dioxide levels. Global warming, unlike other forms of environmental destruction, requires not only awareness of the damage done in a series of displaced elsewhere, but also a recognition of damage being done in another time, in that most strange of locations, the future. It is a crisis that is occurring while concurrently the everyday life of consumer capitalism appears to continue unaffected. In this book, I argue that to consider the current environmental crisis only as an event in the world is to miss its pervasive texturing of contemporary consciousness. It exists not only as scientific data, but also as a reordering of the social around a new set of coordinates. The mystifying complexity of this new totality requires thinking not only in different scales of time and space, but also in shifts between intimate everyday practices and great impersonal earth systems. The evidence of damage read in the material of the earth emerges as the kind of teleological endpoint of the current trajectory. It presents a critique, a moral critique of modernity and the progress of human society towards a particular standard of living, and a refutation of certain cultural and epistemological assumptions. It occupies the space of the early 21st century, even as other crises in world political configurations, in economics, in the distribution of debt, in the global distribution of violence, continue to take place. and it occupies this as a kind of background that continually exerts pressure on the foreground. Okay, so I'm going to look at three ways, three domains in which this pressure registers in existing ways of thinking and living. First, it produces a conceptual crisis related to nature as independent background that provides the conditions of possibility for a distinct and separate human existence. In the 1990s, this took the form of an anxiety about the end of nature. Climate change, by affecting all aspects of the world, undermined the possibility of a nature independent of human activities. The end of nature signified a condition in the world, but also a psychic loss. Nature could no longer be regarded as this numinous presence offering an escape from human society, and appeared instead as attenuated and haunted by loss. This requires, according to Michel Serres, a fundamental rethinking of the relationship between background and foreground. Global history, he writes, enters nature. Global nature enters history. This is something utterly new in philosophy. In 2000, this conceptual shift was formalized in a proposal by the chemist Paul Crutzen, who suggested that the current geological age be renamed the Anthropocene in order to signify the impact of human activities on the geological and ecological substrate of the Earth. Climate change and other geophysical changes fundamentally disrupt earlier narratives about nature and the division between the social and the natural. I'm sure you're probably familiar with the great acceleration graphs, some of which are circulating on the PowerPoint right now. And these graphs juxtapose a series of a set of categories relating to human consumption with a set of changes in the Earth system. And they all show this sort of remarkable upswing after the 1950s. And what is interesting for me about those graphs is the way they invite into a kind of intimate proximity these very different kinds of knowledge. They place in a single conceptual frame the concrete everyday world of traffic and cell phone use with the culture of modernity embodied in glossy advertisements for new cars and cell phone networks, alongside the abstract knowledge of rising global levels of carbon dioxide and the increase in Earth's surface temperature. The second crisis that I think is interesting in relation to this topic is a crisis in knowledge uncertainty. And I'm not talking here about the production of doubt, which is very characteristic of climate change denialists. But even those who are convinced that of the accuracy of global warming are subject to uncertainty about the degree of increase and the precise effect of climate change. Despite sophisticated and detailed scientific research into change over time, the immense complexity of Earth systems means that the predictions about the future proliferate. And here I introduce this idea of the subjunctive mood. The subjunctive mood describes a grammatical form used to talk about events we are not certain will happen. If something, then something else. If temperature were to rise by 4 degrees. And there's this real difficulty in trying to respond to a crisis which is happening in the future. By claiming that we live in the subjunctive, I don't want to undermine the claims made by climate scientists, but rather to draw attention to the fact that accepting climate change does not mean, or means accepting a kind of unpredictability of effects and uncertainty about the future. I also want to link a third kind of crisis to this idea of what happens when we are confronted by climate change. And that is a crisis in value. And David Foster and Brett Clark have argued in their discussion of consumer society, that what people are taught to value and consume in today's society are not use values, reflecting genuine needs that have limits, but symbolic values, which are by nature unlimited. This is not to argue that highly disposable commodities such as mobile phones and computers do not have a use value, but rather that the precise nature of their functionality is not what drives desire for replacement. In fact, these objects are seldom used to their full capacity, and for most users exist only as an attractive potentiality. So Sujik talks about the fact that never have we had more possessions, never have but we make less and less use of them. And of course Sujik is director of London Design Museum, he's referring to populations in developed countries. But there is a kind of set of expectations about goods branded as valuable and their relation to what constitutes a life worth living, a life of value, that circulates around the world through the global culture industry. The crisis of global warming cannot be separated from these more ephemeral transformations in the modes of human activity taking place at the level of culture. Although the phrase conspicuous consumption seems particularly suited to describe the activities of contemporary consumer society, it was first used over 100 years ago to describe a very different society, although one which is obviously contains elements which have intensified in the past century. Faustine Berlin published his Anatomy of Contemporary Society in 1899, locating it within a historical trajectory, starting with the archaic hunter and warrior, and moving through the feudal lord, the monarch, to the individual, and the modern industrial age. He used the phrase conspicuous consumption to describe a form of consumption designed to enhance status. Berlin's basic argument locates the impulse to consume in invidious comparison. Use, he explains, in its technical sense, to describe a comparison of persons with a view to rating and grading them in respect of relative worth or value. Consumption attributes value to the consumer because it takes place not in isolation, but within a social context, one in which comparison with other forms, forms the fundamental basis for establishing a sense of self-worth. Drawing on an evolutionary narrative that identifies a continuity between the distribution of value in traditional societies and those in modern societies. In both, he suggests certain activities not linked to productive labor, like warfare and hunting, are associated with honor and status, while others, including the drudgery of everyday survival, are associated with debasement and a lack of status. In all forms of human society, the impulse to consume beyond what is necessary for survival is driven by the principle of pecuniary emulation, or the desire of the individual to prove their worth in relation to others through activities which display their worth, conspicuous leisure, and conspicuous consumption. So for my purposes, Berlin is quite useful for various reasons. One, because he doesn't see modernity as a break, doesn't see this break between tradition and modernity, but there's a kind of long continuation. What one society does is it simply introduces new canons of taste, but its logic is not more rational than earlier forms. And Berlin is really interested in trying to prove that modern society has a kind of barbarism. There's nothing civilized about modern society. But of course, there's another way you can look at that. And what Berlin does as well is he kind of looks at the way in which there's a kind of global circulation of value between objects and people. And this is quite interesting, I think, in relation to environmental crisis produced by consumption. And of course, 90 years before Bourdieu's distinction offers a set of terms for understanding consumption as a social performance, not as an individual act. between people, not as a relationship between people and objects. Okay, so of course, in some ways, what the great acceleration graphs do is they measure exactly this, the increase in consumption. The expansion of the scope and effectiveness of advertising, its development of a system of judgments about value, its intimate integration into new technological developments, and its extension into personal presentation through the work of publicity are all refined in that period of described by the great acceleration, which is from the 1950s onwards. And in one of the chapters, I try and look at some detail of this in relation to the diamond industry, and the way the diamond industry produces a whole set of adverts and kind of publicity material around creating diamonds as valuable in America during that period after the war. And the other thing Bundlen does, which I think is interesting, is he offers an example of an allegorical mode of reading. Under Veblen's gloomy gaze, Adorno notes, lawns and walking sticks, umpires and domestic animals become revealing allegories of the barbarism of culture. And although at times Veblen's book seems to be like this relentless reiteration of his central point, he has this very minute, he pays this very minute attention to everyday experience, which I think is an interesting and necessary way of engaging with this, the everyday. The first set of acceleration graphs used the number of McDonald's worldwide as the measure of globalization. And while this was changed in the 2010 version of the chart, which is the one that's up on the screen, to the less suggestive category of foreign direct investment, the implication remains that what the graphs chart is primarily the scale of human consumption. What persists, despite the change in terminology, is the culture of consumption itself, the work of extending commodification into all areas of life, particularly to increasing absorption of nature into the processes of commodification. In the face of the manifest impossibility of what is needed, a theory of everything, the work of this book, which is a gathering or assembling, allows for the production of temporary and contingent relationships that refuse the division of the world into discrete sectors and scholarship into compartmentalized disciplinary logics. Such arrangements are deliberate works of interpretation designed to bring certain details into the domain of attention in a new way. Right, I'm going to skip the little section on the nature industry, but we can also talk about that in more detail, and to look at the post-colony and what is specific about the post-colony. Because of the particular history of economic development in the post-colony, the commodification of nature has followed a different trajectory from what it took in such countries as the UK and USA, where a lot of this writing about environmental crisis emerges from. In the absence of extensive industrialization, nature is commoditized as natural resource, nature reserve, and more frequently as farmland for biofuels and as carbon credits. In the contemporary global culture, the post-colony remains the place of raw material. At an AU summit in 2006, Hugo Chavez rhetorically asserted Latin America and Africa's potential for development by identifying Africa's natural resources. Africa is not a poor continent. How can Africa be poor, having oil, diamonds, cobalt, wine, forests, all kinds of minerals? Yet natural resources in the post-colony have an ambiguous status. In 1993, British economist Richard Horty coined the phrase resource curse to describe the curious effect of natural resources on development. developing economy, suggesting that in many cases, instead of generating wealth, mineral resources distort economies and lead to instability and conflict. In this book, I argue that Marx's phrase primitive accumulation has particular resonance for an investigation of the nature industry and the post-company. Marx uses the phrase primitive accumulation to describe a particular moment in the prehistory of capitalism when accumulation takes place through violent dispossession. In a short chapter of Capital called The Secret of Primitive Accumulation, he describes the mythical past imagined by political economists as consisting of two sorts of people, the diligent, intelligent, and above all, frugal elite, and the other lazy rascals spending their substance and more in riotous living. He continues in a sarcastic tone, and from this original sin dates the poverty of the great majority who, despite all their labor, have up till now nothing to sell but themselves, and the wealth of the few that increases constantly, although they have long since ceased to work. In place of this mythical process of natural selection in which the elites accumulate capital through the diligence of their own labor, Marx offers an account of the actual history of accumulation, the history of expropriation written in the annals of mankind in letters of blood and fire. So a quote from Marx. He draws his empirical evidence for this from a moment in British history, the enclosure of the commons. In order for capitalism to appear as a non-coercive system of free labor, the violence of this expropriation, which is the foundation of the capitalist class, has to be forgotten. Thus the need for the mythical past presented by political economists. Subsequent theorists have suggested that instead of locating primitive accumulation in the past, it should be recognized as an ongoing part of capitalist system, and in particular of imperial expansion. And Rosa Luxemburg was one of the first to develop this idea, arguing that capitalism requires the existence of non-capitalist forms of production as a market for its surplus, and as a source of raw materials for production, and as a resource of potential wage labor. A natural economy thus confronts capitalism at every turn with rigid barriers. Capitalism must therefore always and everywhere fight a battle of annihilation against every form of natural economy that it encounters. The principal method in this struggle are political force, oppressive taxation by the state, and cheap goods. In his article, Disaggregating Primitive Accumulation, Robert Nichols suggests that instead of seeing land simply as a commodity like any other, although clearly it can be bought, sold, or stolen like other commodities, Marx saw land as also located in nature, an instrument of purposeful of labor, not simply an object on which labor was performed. Dispossession thus involves not simply the theft of land, but something more complex. Nichols writes, Marx's focus on land is the particular expression of a generalizable insight, namely that dispossession entails the appropriation of and consolidated class monopoly in the mediated metabolic interaction of humanity and the productive resources of the earth. Nichols suggests that the term dispossession is more precise and concludes that it comes to name a distinct logic of capitalist development grounded in the appropriation and monopolization of the productive powers of the natural world in a manner that orders but does not directly determine social pathologies related to dislocation, class stratification, and or exploitation, while simultaneously converting the planet into a homogeneous and universal means of production. Although Nichols prefers the term dispossession, I argue that primitive accumulation has a particular relevance for describing what happens to nature in the post-colony. Through the settlers' refusal to recognize any form of property except private ownership, nature in the post-colony is cast as a wilderness uniquely available for accumulation, as raw materials, as wildlife, and as land. So the post-colony provides a unique place from which to reconsider nature not only as ideological construct, certainly still performs this function, but also as materiality, as an assemblage of lively particular objects that act on human sociality in profound ways. This is not only because throughout the long history of imperial conquest, it was always against nature that civilization had to strive to impose European ideals, or that even within the so-called post-industrial era, Africa remains the source of raw materials for industry, but also because there is within African intellectual traditions certain occluded modes of thought that have always recognized the interdependence of human and non-human worlds. For Schoenberger, the term post-colony designates a condition of occupying a specific historical trajectory, that of societies emerging from the experience of colonization and the violence which the colonial relationship involves. It is an act of naming which draws attention to the fact that the defining character of this collective identification is history, not geography. In this book, the examples are from Africa, but they do not speak for Africa or impose on it an impossible and emergent homogeneity. For the purposes of the argument of the book, certain other commonalities, characteristic of the post-colony, are relevant. And the first of these is the idea that the post-colony is the space subject to the discourse of development. Caught in a temporal lag, it is faced with the task of catching up with the developed world, although the precise nature of this destination, the condition of being developed, often remains vague. In the most general terms, it is associated with more efficient systems, a growing economy, industrialization, and a stable government. But it also contains the promise of a certain lifestyle of consumption and freedom of choice, in which the aspiration and target is an imagined luxury middle-class existence. The post-colony, as the name indicates, has a discontinuous history, as it was not simply invaded, it was also civilized, in inverted commas. As a result, it is the site of discontinuous and at times competing regimes of value. This post-colony was subjected to a compulsion to modernize that addressed itself specifically to the forms of everyday life. And recently edited a special issue on the cultural politics of dirt in Africa, and several of the papers look at the way in which the idea of dirt was used to promote a particular kind of lifestyle, values a particular kind of lifestyle. And the introduction of commodities was key to that process. The history of the post-colony, I argue, is defined by what I call a primitive accumulation of nature. And this is this violent accumulation that continues to characterize the contemporary moment. Africa occupies a strange place in the global economy as the source of nature, raw materials, on the one hand, unspoiled landscape and natural economies, places that have been incompletely penetrated by capitalist logic. The violence of accumulation includes both overt or spectacular violence, the militarized extraction industries, the structural violence of political and economic pressure, and of course also that slow violence of environmental damage that Rob Nixon talks about. And the characteristic of slow violence is that it's typically the effects are divorced from the causes by displacements over time and space. It's a violence that is neither spectacular or instantaneous, but rather incremental and accretive, its calamitous repercussions playing out across temporal scales. And slow violence is, of course, an important concept for understanding environmental damage and the unintended consequences or side effects of extraction, production, and even military invasion in a range of different contexts. So the difficulty, of course, with slow violence is trying to make it visible, because of course it doesn't have any kind of visible form. It's not spectacular in any way. So the post-colony is a space that is subject to the social and environmental costs of global production. In his book, The Social Cost of Production, William Kapp, an economist briefly associated with the Frankfurt York argues that in working out the cost of production, those factors designated as externalities are in fact the costs borne by society as a whole. Capitalism, he says, must be regarded as an economy of unpaid costs, unpaid insofar as a substantial portion of the actual cost of production remains unaccounted for in entrepreneurial outlays. Instead, they are shifted and ultimately borne by third persons or the community as a whole. For CAP, these include both health costs to workers and environmental degradation as a result of the production process. Post-colony, I argue, is a space particularly burdened by such costs. And this is evidenced, for instance, in the differential responses by oil companies to oil spills in American and Nigerian waterways. The post-colony is characterized by this continuous geography made up of designated spaces of value separate from the polity as a whole. If mining offers one example of enclaved spaces of natural value, game parks offer another. Because of its low levels of industrialization, Africa is particularly rich in this form of leftover nature. Upmarket reserves directed towards international tourist industries often are owned by large corporations. Frame their ownership of land in Africa in terms of a global duty to preserve nature and the environment. And James Ferguson notes how they often exist as independent entities linked into the global economy through technology, but separate from surrounding land and society. So, remember, the designation post-colony also defines a particular relation to time or temporality. As an age, the post-colony encloses multiple durées made up of discontinuities, reversals, inertias, and swings that overlay one another, interpenetrate one another, and envelop one another, an entanglement. And Mbembe goes on to suggest that to consider the post-colony requires a rethinking of the order of temporality. To think relevantly about this time, the quote, that is appearing, this passing time, meant abandoning conventional views, for these only perceive time as a current that carries individuals and societies from a background into a foreground, with the future emerging necessarily from the past of the past and following the past, itself irreversible. But of central interest was the peculiar time that might be called the time of experience and existence, the time of entanglement. Considering African experience, Mbembe claims, requires thinking about time differently. It involves accepting that time is not a series, but an interlocking of present, past, and futures, that time is made up of disturbances, of bundles of unforeseen events, and that it cannot be described according to a simple pattern of rupture and stability. The disrupted temporal scheme introduced by climate change in some ways resembles the temporal order of the post-colony. In both, the catastrophic, unpredictable, perhaps unimaginable futures appears to be existing alongside the present, with the past persisting in this accretion of effects that cannot be left behind. In this narrative, the value of the post-colony again lies in its lack of development. The by now notorious remark by William World Bank President Lawrence Summers, which served as the epigraph for Nixon's book, "I have always thought that countries in Africa are vastly underpolluted," reflects this understanding of the post-colony as a source of a particular kind of value. The relatively unpolluted environment allows the post-colony to become a source of a new commodity produced by the Kyoto Protocol, carbon credits, in which what has become the dominant global response to climate change, which is a further commoditization of nature, not as raw material, but as absence of carbon emissions. But one of the strange things about carbon emissions in Africa is that the carbon credits market actually is skewed in favor of developing countries in a number of different ways. So for instance, within Europe, trade much higher than they do in Africa. The rationalities, and this is a quote by Anna Liberman, the rationalities of financial markets, the carbon credits are cheaper in Africa because investments in the developing world are considered riskier. In this study, kinds of things that I engage with in this book. I mostly focus on South Africa, examples from South Africa. And South Africa, I think, is quite an interesting case because it's both exemplary and an exceptional, or strange site for investigative nature in the post-colony. In a curious configuration of time and space, the contemporary moment in South Africa is deeply entangled with the global nature industry, a diverse configuration that might include Monsanto, which sells genetically modified seeds in offices around the country, concern about wildlife extinction, environmental justice, nature reserves, organic produce, farmers' markets, while at the same time suffering the distortion of its own particular history of land disposition and mineral extraction. The surface is present as a tension, a conflict within the heart of the polity about ownership. Who does nature belong to, and where does nature belong? Okay, just to do this very briefly. Some of climate change science requires a different way of thinking about the relation between science and the state, science and national narratives. Climate change science, as Klein points out, produces the natural world in opposition to the ideology of neoliberal state because it registers the impact of economic activity at a geomorphic level. Conversations about climate change are characterized by a perceived acceptance of the inevitability of capitalism and the sanctity of, quote, life as we know it, or the culture of consumption. Acts to mitigate the effects of climate change are framed as necessary in order to maintain an already existing lifestyle. Yet the style in which we live is not a matter of fact. It is a complex negotiation of desire, choice, necessity, attitude, culture, history, and innovation. It is an orientation towards the world and to other people, a conscious and unconscious distribution of what is considered valuable. In the chapters of this book, I try to track some of this fractured landscape of desire and habits through which the world is constituted as valuable, as a resistance to the promise of totality offered by the global and the urban system. I put together fragments of specific habits of consumption and fantasies about style and the possibilities and impossibilities of styling life differently.
Since the idea of apocalypse is a trope that seems to have inflected our politics and our social life for some time, I think all the way back to Kropenzano's discussion of whites in South Africa in 85 and the discussion of the impending, of their stasis, of their waiting, they're waiting for a kind of doom that was coming with post-apartheid South Africa. And obviously that doesn't touch environmental questions, but insofar as part of what you're trying to bring together are two very different discourses in this particular location. I'm curious about those images and how you might respond to them, and particularly the notion of the apocalyptic.
Yeah, well, I guess the apocalyptic is very much part of the narrative of climate change, isn't it? It's just kind of fantasy, and there are many films and novels that represent this, the apocalyptic version of climate change. And I suppose what's attractive about that is the spectacular nature of it, which seems to be both a... I mean, I always see these climate change films as having this, containing this kind of ambivalence about consumption, because they are both like a class. There's something satisfying in seeing these cities totally overgrown with glass and consumer goods just totally pointless. There's a kind of pleasure there, isn't there, as well, as a kind of fear. There's an interesting way in which there's a sense of satisfaction that emerges in the kind of total overturn of the system of values that we are caught up in. But of course, the difficulty is with those kinds of narratives is what can they have any political effect? Because and what is the politics of climate change? One of the last chapter of the book is about advice literature, and the way in which many kinds of environmental narratives, a lot of writing about the environment now, sort of takes the form of advice literature, of how we can live better. But in some ways it's such a fragile, this invitation to change, to make small different choices is such a fragile response to what's quite an overwhelming, what needs a far more radical restructuring, I think.
Simon?
Can you stand up so I can? I'm Simon Becker, I'm one of the old people in the department. I enjoyed what you put to us very much indeed, and I look forward to reading the manuscript, the book. First, I'd like to just comment about my take on the Anthropocene, which you mentioned.
Sure.
When I started trying to make sense of it, what I realized when I did a bit of homework on the internet and on Google, was that it has to do with the increasing influence of humankind on nature.
Yes.
There was a debate about when would it make sense to start, why then, and also who within humankind are most responsible for this effect on nature. What it also, and this is the sociologist speaking now, what it also implies is that if it is humankind that is having this huge, tremendous influence, bad influence, as you've pointed out in many of your graphs, it is also possible for humankind to try and change, adjust humankind's behavior so as to at least mitigate, if not improve, the impact. I mean, that's the other implication of the use of the idea of Anthropocene, if I'm pronouncing it correctly. Which leads me to my question. I don't know whether the question is a fair one. I mean, when I write the few articles I still write, when I have a number of graduate students, I use a rather rational, possibly mechanical approach to their work by saying, you must answer what has happened. That is, what is the juxtaposed relationship between the nature industry in the post-colony, why is that relationship as it is? And that's backward looking, that's historical. And then I often say to them, and I'm saying this to myself, and maybe this is a cop-out, I say there is a third question, and that is, what is to be done? And often, not always, in my own writing and for them, I say, don't go there. Because it's very difficult, and it's not historical, and you don't have facts. My question is, when you put your manuscript together, how did you cope with that third question? Because there must have been the temptation to get into what are they trying to do about it, in Paris and elsewhere. I mean, how have you handled the what is to be done? Because I'm certain when the book comes out, people are going to say to you, well, what do you think should be done?
Is this a blueprint? No, it isn't, sadly. I didn't really go into, the kind of political interventions that people are trying to make and into the summits and the arrangement. I didn't really go into that in a lot of detail. Partly because the kinds of texts that I were dealing with had much more to do with trying to articulate everyday experience with the kinds of things that constrain our behavior. So they come in a little bit, I mean, I suppose my argument, and this is where my disciplinary background comes in, my argument is about, and I mentioned this right at the beginning, but let me go a bit lost, which is about how narratives about climate change allow us to say certain things and not say other things. So how can we escape the kinds of narratives that dominate and only allow us to say certain things about the crisis and how we can respond to it? And my, I suppose my argument is for a particular kind of reading of texts and of the everyday, which is this kind of allegorical reading, which doesn't perhaps come through so clearly in the introduction. But so, yeah, I kind of, a bit of a skepticism about the idea that these things can be mitigated at a through small changes, I suppose, emerges in the book. I mean, we had this talk at Wiser, and one of the people involved was an American scholar, and she said that she's involved in some of these government discussions around, I don't know, I can't remember the details, but around how do we cope with climate change. And she said the one thing that is absolutely, they won't contemplate, they won't go there, is changes in lifestyle. Like the changes in the American lifestyle. They're not interested. You can't address that. So in some ways that what I'm interested in is, well, can we address the question of changing that sort of everyday experience in various ways? And how can we read these various things that emerge that are responses to climate change? You know? I mean, one of these images that I have up on the screen is the biodome. The biodome is these sort of funny dome things. The biodomes are part of this thing called the Eden Project. And the Eden Project's fantasy is that it's going to get biomes from all over the world in Cornwall and keep them safe so that when everything else is destroyed by climate change, there'll still be these seed banks of a little bit of West African tropical forest, a little bit of, I don't know, everything, a little bit of Cape Mediterranean, fynbos. So there's a sense in which there's a sort of project of maintaining in this highly artificial environment little bits of the world, little fragments of the world, of the natural world. And so, I mean, and it's a hugely expensive project, of course. They had to get masses of funding, the EU gave them masses of funding, because it's a project that appeals at some deep level to people's anxiety about this end of nature. But at the same time, it seems quite a ridiculous project at the same time. I mean, partly because they discover that it's almost impossible to maintain plants, like biomes, little ecosystems in such small areas. So things keep dying off. I don't know if that answers any one question.
So just to push you there, I mean, the day zero rhetoric in Cape Town did require certain kinds of lifestyle stories, which pushes against certain kinds of lifestyle things. You know, not in a major way necessarily, but showerless and you know, save your water, etc. So I wonder how one fits that in. But I'm gonna take this more hands, so I'm gonna take that and I'm just gonna throw that back at you and then Stephen and then Shaib.
Yeah, I think that point is correct. I mean, apparently Cape Town is quite unprecedented. You know that it's dropped from something like 1.2 billion liters of water per day to 510.
Yeah.
So that is being touted as this unprecedented. unprecedented shift. And what is interesting is how the behavioral scientists are explaining it. So they're claiming that this was a great success in how you can produce behavioral change at a population level, and that their discipline was directly involved. And we know now Tony Leon's public relations company came up with the concept of day zero.
Right.
What happens when the counter message comes from politicians, because it's not a useful message at a certain point? They say, well, actually, we're never going to go to day zero, we never were going to.
Mm.
I mean, it's going to be really interesting to track that.
Mm.
Do any of these water-saving practices stick
yes.
beyond the apocalyptic day zero scenario once that's received it? So, I mean,
I suppose the issue is the counter-narratives. So on one hand, there's the very immediate narrative of day zero, but on the other hand, there's this very kind of insidious counter-narrative around cleanliness and around kind of sanitation and what is required of people in terms of maintaining a certain lifestyle or standard of living. And I think that counter-narrative is stronger. I mean, in some ways, day zero relies on that, because it creates this fear of a total breakdown of standard of living. Therefore, how we'll save a little bit now in order to put off that kind of panic of, well, we can't have it all, you know. So I think it is a very specialized case, a very localized case. I think the difficulty with climate change is so abstract, and it's such a difficult thing to get people to imagine. And the common narrative of consumption is so powerful that it's almost, it seems very hard to interrupt.
Shall you have a diary?
Particular presented in very abstract terms, very general terms, and I do recognize that. I do have another chapter in which I look specifically at Africa. It's called Africa in the Anthropocene, and it's I try and track some of that, the way in which Africa gets fitted into this narrative of the Anthropocene. Because what I hope I'm doing is I'm actually talking against that kind of the what happens. And it's not so much true, this is again the problem of always writing which is a little late, but what happens initially, at least, with the idea of the Anthropocene is the idea of the human. The human, humans are impacting on, and of course, it's very differential way in which humans impact. And so my more recent work is actually on a different set of graphs called the Cape Climate Data Graphs, and they look at carbon emissions according to country, and according to sector, and according to all of these different things. And then I try and compare Nigeria and South Africa, and look at the different ways in which these graphs can direct us to particular practices, particular everyday practices in different countries, and what this means. So I think you're right, there is a tendency to generalization. So the book is a bit of a strange assemblage of things. So the first few chapters are very much, as you say, about how, more or less, how Africa gets taken up in this global narrative, particularly in various, so in the American Museum of Natural History and in this Eden project, and then also Continental Gabonism, but anyway, in particular texts. And then in the last three are really about particular examples in South Africa. And so I think there is a danger, and people have alerted me to this before, like generalizing from South Africa to Africa, or to the post-colony. So I have somewhere done a kind of attempt to think about what you can say, the kinds of generalizations you can make from a particular example, which I think, at least in this kind of book, are possible. But of course, people could also challenge me. But I mean, that is a bit of a shaky area.
Can you take three in one go?
Sure.
I've got Laurine, Emery, and Stephen again.
Can I start?
Yeah.
I was particularly fascinated with your outline of Christ at the beginning.
Oh, yeah?
Where you talk about these three different ways in which crisis can be expressed here. So an environmental crisis in knowledge, which comes with uncertainty, and crisis in value. And there's this new body of literature where they all talk about crisis again, what crisis is as a temporal category, as it was initially called by Reinhard Koselleck, the historian, and now new work by Janet Reutemann, and also Mbembe himself, where it's all about taking crisis as this idea of judging time, which, as you also mentioned, it disrupts linearity, but when we talk about day zero, different forms of crisis, the Anthropocene, we're always making a certain diagnosis or a certain judgment about what this temporal moment or this moment is right now. And my question is formulated around, or the question I have is, so what I found is interesting here is, or my question to you would be, how these three moments of crisis you were speaking about speak to each other. So you put them out, which was fascinating to talk about, like how certain groups of people have less use for different kinds of possessions, but how does it work together with an environmental crisis? Or we have an environmental crisis which also is the blind spot for the production of certain knowledge. So it's not only an uncertainty of knowledge, it's also stabilizes some knowledge at the same time. So these moments of crisis speak to each other, and that's what I was particularly interested in.
So mine follows Shahid's comment. I think there is a possibility of generalization. And you put it clearly when you say that the post-colony has nothing to do with geography, which is not about location, but it's more to do with history.
Right.
So if you take that point, there's a possibility of, you know, try and generalize.
Okay.
So that would probably address Shahid's point.
Okay, thank you.
So now, I really like your talk. I mean, it shows how creative you are. In terms of imagination, you have a large imagination. So thinking the post-colonial ways in which men defend it and link it to nature. I mean, that's really fascinating for me. So now the question is, if we take that that kind of framing of the post-colonial, now how different it is from the colonial? Because if the post-colonial is precisely what you described, so now I mean, how different it is from the colonial?
Mm-hmm.
So that's how it is.
Stephen?
If there's somebody else, I can write this.
I think the
issues raised are really interesting, and I'm really looking forward to the book. And I'm wondering, it's kind of quite a simple question, whether you use this concept of capitalism, which is a way of trying to break with this idea that an undifferentiated human is responsible, or humankind is responsible for the finance.
Yeah.
All
right, so. Question. Difficult, but yes. I think you're right that in some ways I present them as two as discrete units, these different crises, but I don't really link in how exactly they're articulated either with each other, this is what I think they're saying, or with the environmental crisis itself. And I suppose one way I would see them as, well, maybe they don't all link in the same way, but certainly the one. Crisis in value is deeply implicated in the environmental crisis in two ways. One around the fact that this particular way of valuing objects is what drives the machine of consumerism in a way. So it's it underlies the kind of acceleration that we see in the graphs. And perhaps in another way, that it creates a framework for understanding value, or how we understand value, which makes it very difficult to see nature in a different way. It creates a kind of set of well, let me rather go with an example. So it makes it seem like the only way in which we can understand, we can use the fact that Africa is not polluted is by granting it carbon credits, so like turning something, an absence, into a kind of measurable unit, which then can become a commodity and which can be sold on the carbon market. And the question of knowledge and the crisis of knowledge, I think, is also a tricky one, because in some ways underlying argument there is that knowledge depends on a certain stability, a certain natural stability of the conditions of the production of knowledge, and that once these get disrupted, then the question of knowledge itself is called into question. But maybe I need to think through that a little bit more detail. Remember what the third crisis was?
Conceptual.
The conceptual crisis around nature as independent. So that really comes from this whole, actually more than the 1990s, this movement around the end of nature and what does it mean that nature ends. This American environmentalist wrote a book called The End of Nature, and he says that once nature has ended, we no longer have that. We no longer have that sense of our humans as independent, or nature as independent from humans, as a kind of backdrop. And this idea that in the past we could consider the background as separate from the foreground, that human activity was the foreground, the start of history, nature was the background. And but now that arrangement of background and foreground is no longer possible, that the background has become the foreground, become what shapes history. I'm not sure I really answered your question, but I think I'll try and think that through in more detail. The second question, which is about history and using history as a way of idea, and I'll certainly follow up on that. How is the post-colony different from the colony? I think in one of the chapters, actually in the three chapters in which I looked at, I actually looked at the first one is about the colony, not the post-colony. So I suppose I'm using the term post-colony a little loosely, perhaps, to refer to. Perhaps I'm using it because I'm interested in predominantly in the present moment, but of course the present moment is acted upon by the past, and so my particular interest in the first chapter, which is on diamonds, is looks at the history of diamond mining in South Africa, because I'm interested in what it means. I'm interested in this idea of raw materials, and particularly I'm interested in the way in which these raw materials shift from. So diamonds have a particular value in South Africa, and they become more and more valuable the further away they go from the colony. So it never actually generates profit for the people who originally own the diamonds. So the diamonds is it's a strange, I suppose it's a kind of a reflection on how value works in relation to raw materials. So I would say the colony is not different from the post-colony. It's not entirely different from the post-colony. Stephen's question on the capitalism. Yes, I have looked at that, and it does come in a bit later. Why did I not include it here? I can't remember. I suppose the question I'm interested in is why the Anthropocene becomes so popular. And what it does in terms of what need it meets in public opinion. So that's why, in some ways, I'm focusing on the Anthropocene. But I think you're quite right that my own engagement with it is an attempt to reflect on what work it's doing ideologically, and using the capitalist scene and our way to work that way does enable me to do something to interrupt that in some way. I think that is precisely the point
of my
consumption.
Sure.
Hi,
Matt. Thank you for your talk. It was very interesting. My question is centered around development. Right? I'm trying to understand. So, I come from West Africa, and I can see the difference between the two societies and how things are sort of nature is, and so on. I'm trying to understand South Africa compared to the Pacific Nigeria.
Yes.
And I'm trying to figure out like how do we better our society without, having to fit into the globalized world, because you mentioned a little bit earlier about the conversation.
Yes.
And how things have been taken from nature to expand the society of ours.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, to develop one's society, you kind of have to take on nature.
Yes.
And we basically faced with this problem that hasn't been created by us and now we have to deal with. Because
yes.
We can't go to Shia's question about who. Because I know Nigeria is still green as well, like this. There's a lot of different. So should we stop and live with the problems created by the Western world? Or should we, or how can we go about developing without causing more harm to nature?
Mm.
That's my question.
Okay, if we can get it. Yeah, I mean, that was something I had thought about before I came to talk. That's an interesting field, right? To my point of question of how development actually takes place in Africa. Often, I think that's what you're pointing out. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Often the post-colony does not actually develop its own methods of development.
Yes.
Because the hierarchy of values is already established.
Mm-hmm.
And so I encountered recently some people like who work in South Africa, even with NGO, design
yes.
Whatever those methods are.
Mm.
But I think in that sense, yeah, your work, I can see how it speaks to me. Go back to this question of, I think now Emily can be some more talking about history. So what Hugo Chavez says, you know,
mm-hmm.
something like he expounds the value of that of resources.
Mm-hmm.
He was obviously very famous for this, and he was
mm-hmm.
able to do it because
yeah.
he had all this oil.
Yeah.
And then if we look then at the case of the oil spills in Nigeria, and then we need to say, for example, where the screens come from. You know, these terrible reports of how our screens are being mined in the Congo. And it's definitely an entangled history, but it's very much this uneven colonial history.
Yeah.
It's still the same, the rest of the time, it's still bad, you know,
mm.
you know. I'm just wondering, like, how do you, if you have maybe you need to address that,
yeah.
you know, actually head on, because it seems always that there's a disconnect, that there's a break.
Yeah.
So the idea also, I think you presented, the absence of extensive commodification in Africa.
Yeah.
I think the whole politics of land now is precisely the opposite.
Mm.
Land is entirely commodified
mm.
in South Africa, so there's no support and ownership. And
yeah.
People are saying, you know,
that's
interesting.
Okay, so, yeah?
This will be the last round, so any final questions or thoughts people have? I wanted to ask you a little more about the. We had these very evocative thoughts at the beginning about the modes of presentation in particular and the role of juxtaposition. You know, you meditated on the question of and,
yes.
and what kind of conjunction that is, and then you sort of intimated or suggested that the implied perhaps that putting together different images in a way that you're going to draw inspiration from them, you know, would itself contain a certain kind of politics. And so I'd like you to perhaps say a bit more about that.
Okay, so the first question. I mean, it is quite shocking when you look at these Cape Town data graphs, which show carbon emissions according to continent, and Africa's emissions are negligible. They are really almost non-existent. And in Nigeria, they're all from the little. Nigeria and South Africa and Egypt are the ones that are slightly higher than anyone else, but still negligible according to the world emissions. Nigeria's are from fugitive emissions mainly, which is of course the oil extraction industry. So you're quite right that it's a problem that we are, that Africa is confronted with, which they did not make. The question of how you can develop without destroying nature, I think, is not one I can answer, but I think I have some negative things you cannot do, and one of them is about, well, for me at least, it's about the question of what is constituted as valuable, and I don't believe that nature has to be left alone. I don't know, one of my students did a very interesting thesis a few years ago about poetry in the Niger Delta region, which is a response to extraction industry. And he talks about a very different way of viewing nature as a kind of utility, as a resource, and how that is not the same as a kind of Western idea of nature should be preserved and enclaved, and, you know, sort of the opposite of the Eden Project's idea that we can just put it in a safe space, separate it all. And I think the question is, can we regard nature as a resource but not a commodity, I suppose is the question. Can we not let it get sucked into that circulation, that global circulation of value? And I think it's a question of, I don't know what it's a question, it's a question maybe of thinking about how things are assigned value, and how we can consider alternative narratives for assigning things value. I don't know if that's already a tiny helpful answer, but it's as far as I can go. Your question was more about.
something which has become intensely commodified, and I think you are right, especially in South Africa. And I suppose there are various movements in NGOs who are trying to think about land differently, about land that should belong to people who work it, and things like that. So, and of course, Marx's idea that land is not a commodity in the sense that other things are commodities, because it involves this interaction, an interaction which sustains life. And I mean, there are all those people who I've been reading, which I find quite interesting, crazy Catholic, Ivan Illich, you know, the anti-development, post-development theorists, and I think they all have interesting ideas about let's not think in terms of development. I mean, development is a very particular trajectory. Let's try and interrupt that trajectory. And I think they've written interesting things on that. but I think the question of juxtaposition is an interesting one, and I left out that section in the introduction. The question is about language, and it's about critique, and whether critique is entirely exhausted or only mostly exhausted. And this guy called Robert Schuller, Kant, also Adorno scholar, talks about the fact that when Adorno and Horkheimer used the term culture industry, it was a shocking juxtaposition, because at that time culture was not an industry. And now culture industry, well, we all know what the culture industry is. It seems entirely natural to us that culture is an industry and that it makes money. But culture before was seen as something independent, it was autonomous, it was not subject to the same economic laws as everything else, as Coca-Cola and, you know, whatever else, other commodities. So what I'm trying to do, and he talks about the idea of friction, and that sparks, that you can spark something off if you put things together. If you bring things together in unusual ways, you can actually create a kind of shift in imagination, I guess. And so this is the idea of the juxtaposition, is that almost like you bump things, you create friction by bumping things up against each other. So there's a sense in which you make these unusual combinations, you put them next to each other, and they can sort of jolt people into different ways.
Thank you all for your attention. Thanks to Louise for the hard work, 7 hour answers, and we will reconvene next week.